Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your favorite, most favorite brother in the whole world, Brother Patrick here, coming to you from the overwhelmingly fabulous state of North Carolina. Hope you guys are all doing all right tonight. Been very busy moving, brothers and sisters, and way behind on sleeping and studying and all those things. But the Lord knew from the foundation of the world that I'd be having to be busy moving, and for his glory, brothers and sisters, as you know, as I'm going around in the Philippines to the States, it's all for his glory. Praise God. That's what it's all about, brothers and sisters. You know, nothing else in this world matters. You think I was just wanted to say, you think I was moving around before? I'm standing up now in this place that the Lord made a way for us to be able to rent. I took over somebody's lease, and the lease expires about the time I need to go back to Philippines. So praise God. And they even had a promo rate because they had leased it for a long period of time. So praise God. They got a promotion and moved back where they came from and back to Massachusetts, the lady that was renting this place. And praise God, we were able to even get a discount rate and in a nice place, brothers and sisters. So praise God. By the grace of God, I'll have me a desk next week or a table. I can sit down, a table and chair. I can sit down so it won't be a blur on the screen. But praise God, brothers and sisters. It's the words that matter, not the image, right, brothers and sisters? So praise God for that. I'll be on the, I just wanted to say before I forget, I'll be on the radio tomorrow night. I haven't even mentioned it. I keep forgetting. Tomorrow night I'll be on the Tribulation Now radio with a Brother John. He calls himself Brother John the Baptist. That'll be tomorrow night. I'll be talking about the vision that the Lord had given me with the Lord turning, you know, to the four watches of the night and all those things, brothers and sisters. And the Lord has given me more wisdom on that topic that I haven't had time to talk about in video. So by the grace of God, I'll be mentioning it a new understanding and illumination from the Spirit of God tomorrow night, brothers and sisters. You know, so praise God for that. Just as I mentioned that, you know me, I got to do a little teaching. I just want to say when people talk about hearing from the Lord, you know, we don't say we get a revelation from God. You know, when you're talking about dealing out there with people who, all this theological stuff, when you say revelation, the Bible is a complete revelation of the Lord, but we can get illumination. The Lord can illuminate our mind. Not the Illuminati now, you know, but the Lord can illuminate our mind and give us a rhema word, a word from the Word, and give us deeper understanding and meaning behind the Word of God, brothers and sisters. So that's what we talk about. We say the Lord is showing us something. The Lord is revealing something to us. It's not really revealing, but illuminating is the right word, brothers and sisters. Just a FYI for you guys. Who make videos and hear stuff, when people talk about getting a revelation, it means, you know, like something, a new gospel or something, you know, where cults come from and all that kind of stuff, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, all these kind of groups, they all came out of a new revelation from God, brothers and sisters. And so we as Christians, we don't get a new revelation, but understanding, illumination, a rhema word from God, from his logos is the Greek word for the whole Bible. And Jesus was the Logos, the Word of God. But a rhema is a word from the Word, a quickening of part of the Word to us, brothers and sisters. So anyway, I don't know why I'm going about that, but by the grace of God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, the Lord has just been talking to me tonight about His Majesty. His Majesty. You know, like that song? I haven't heard it in a long time. Ron Canole, I've heard singing. You know, Majesty, worship His Majesty. Unto Jesus be our honor, glory, and praise. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you know, I was just thinking in the Philippines, we went to remote areas in the mountains. I've been to many remote areas where the people have never seen a foreigner before and only know a few English words. And sometimes they learn lots of songs in the local language, but sometimes they'll teach them English songs, just like the one I just sang. And they were teaching this remote area, tribal area, that song. And then they were saying, instead of unto Jesus, they thought it said Uncle Jesus. So they were saying, Uncle Jesus, be honor, glory, and praise. But, you know, praise God, brothers and sisters, they didn't know what the right word was. And there are several songs like that. I could do a whole video on that of them you know, changing it to different words that have a totally different meaning, brothers and sisters. Well, praise God. You know, God has a sense of humor too, brothers and sisters. I mean, he created us, right? So if that doesn't show God has a sense of humor, I don't know what does. But brothers and sisters, the Lord's been talking to me about his majesty, to worship his majesty. God is worthy, brothers and sisters. The Bible says, you know, God is the Lord Jesus should receive the reward of his suffering. You know, and the reward of the Lord's suffering is what? Jesus, before he was crucified in the Gospel of John, chapter 12, the Lord was saying that except a grain of wheat fall to the ground and die, it abideth alone, is the King James wording. But if it falls to the ground, then it will bear 30, 60, 100 fold. And so I've talked about this before. The Lord is leading me to talk about this again. The Lord's reward, as he said, and the Lord said, you know, when it dies, it bears much fruit. So in all things, brothers and sisters, everything we're talking about with God, it is true. Seed, time, and harvest. And you know that as you all know, and we've talked about in the prosperity gospel, of course, it's out of balance when they just only talk about how when you sow financially, you will reap. Even though that's true, brothers and sisters, God will bless us in all things. You reap whatever you sow, the Bible says. If you reap sparingly, you will sow sparingly, you will reap sparingly, the Lord said. Luke chapter 7. But when we sow abundantly, we reap abundantly. 30, 60, 100 fold, brothers and sisters. This is all true. But like I said, the focus on the television, like TBN and all that, is about money. But in all things, brothers and sisters, that we sow, if you sow wickedness, it comes back to you, brothers and sisters. The Bible clearly teaches that. When we sow love, we reap love abundantly. When we sow forgiveness, we reap forgiveness abundantly, brothers and sisters. This is the law that God set up and put into motion for all of creation, brothers and sisters. That's why even these false religions like Hinduism and all that, they call it karma. But really what they're saying comes from the laws that God set up in nature, the natural laws that God set in motion. You reap what you sow. When I take, you know, if I want to grow some apples, I don't plant orange seeds. I plant apple seeds and I get apples. Well, you know, that's a whole nother lesson that the Lord is just putting on me now. You know that when you plant apple seeds, the trees that you get could be different kinds of apples. Maybe lots of people don't know that. I used to have an old man that lived behind me that used to plant apple trees during the Depression. He got a job for the WPA or whatever it was, one of those things. And he was sowing, and he planted apple trees. And back when he was a young man, and he was a World War II veteran also. And he was telling me when I was a kid that, yeah, when you plant apple trees, you have to graft. You have to get a start from an apple tree of the kind of apple you want. And then you find an old apple tree stump, and you chop off the apple tree that's there. If it's a crab apple tree or some kind of apples that you didn't want to eat, you can chop it down, then you take a graft and put it on that stump so there's already a root system, and you would grow the type of apple that you want. Well, brothers and sisters, you know, the Bible tells us about the root, which is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, which is the bloodline of the Messiah. Of course, it's God through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is the root. And we, you know, this is not even nearly anywhere the message I was going to talk about, and the Lord has given it to me, and I'm just going to open it up tonight. And the Lord will give me an expansion on this by his grace, by his wonderful Rhema word grace of the living God. Brothers and sisters, praise his name. Romans chapter 9 and 11, we see where God talks about, through the Apostle Paul, the Lord is talking about how Israel is the natural branches, like of a apple tree. Now that apple tree doesn't bear fruit. It's hewn down and cast into the fire, and then you graft in those wild olive branches it's talking about in that text. But the analogy that the Lord gave me while I'm making this video is about apples, brothers and sisters, that we were grafted in, because this is a whole nother video I need to make it. it's awesome, you know, that the Lord keeps doing to me this live on video, you know, as I'm making the video, because it people can also see how God works, you know, when the flow of His Holy Spirit. So praise God for that. He obviously wants me to do it. I mean, because that's when He's doing it while I'm making a video. So praise His holy name, brothers and sisters, as an example to all of you, brothers and sisters, that you can hear from the Lord. If you're, you know, flowing in His Spirit and surrender your spirit to His Spirit, you can flow in His Spirit anytime, brothers and sisters, by His grace, as you surrender by faith to His will, brothers and sisters. So we are the why, you know, the Lord. See, the quickest way I can say this. When Jesus was going there, like in Mark chapter 11, as I've been teaching about in the past in many videos about faith, when Jesus says in Mark 11, 22, 23, and 24, He says, have faith in God, you know, whomsoever said this mountain be thou removed and cast in the sea, and not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things he saith. When he saith them, he shall have whatsoever he saith. And I've just talked about that recently many times, that the focus of that is the Lord is saying, you speak it out of the abundance of the heart. The mouth speaks, the Lord said. You're speaking faith. But before that, in that text, the reason why Jesus said that, because there was a fig tree that was not bearing fruit. And the Lord Jesus cursed the fig tree for not bearing fruit. And then Peter said, wow, when they came back by the next day, Peter said, wow, Lord, look at the tree you cursed. It's dead in one day. And then the Lord started talking about saying to the mountain, be thou removed, and all that. But the purpose of why Jesus cursed the fig tree, I've talked about this in a video way back, when just like when the Lord and Matthew, when he's there in the temple area before the, during the Passion Week, between Palm Sunday and when he was crucified, he kept going to the temple every day, and he got into a row, you know, a row. You know, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Herodians, as different sects of Judaism, they kept challenging the Lord, you know, like, you know, whose picture's on the, you know, they said, should we pay taxes or not? All those things they did to challenge the Lord Jesus Christ. So one of the things that Jesus talked about, and also in Luke, he said there was, you know, the kingdom of heaven is like a man who owned a tree. And then he went to the tree and the tree wasn't bearing fruit. And so he said, let's cut it down and throw it away. And then the husbandman, the farmer, said, well, you know, let's give it one more try. You know, let me dig around it and put some dung, some manure, you know, fertilizer, and give it another chance. And if it doesn't, you know, grow, bear fruit again next year, then we'll cut it down and cast in the fire. Jesus talked on and on over again, brothers and sisters. And I mentioned this before, another parable. Jesus said, to them about the man who owned a vineyard. And then there were people who working in his vineyard, Israel, who were not giving him the fruit of his vineyard. And so he sent servant after servant to them, and they beat one, stoned another. That's the prophets. You know, it's the parable. Jesus is talking about how God sent prophets to Israel, and they beat them, stoned them, all these things. And so the owner of the vineyard said, I will send my son. They will honor my son. Who was Jesus talking about? Himself, the Christ, the Son of God. But what they did is they killed him. They said, hey, here's the son. He's the heir. If we kill him, then we will own the vineyard. And so they did that. And then Jesus is the one telling this parable there in Matthew about chapter 22 or 23. And then Jesus says to the Pharisees, he asked them, he said, so They killed the son. So what do you think the owner of the vineyard will do to those people for what they've done, all that they've done to him, killing his son and beating all of his servants? And the Pharisees said, oh, he will take the vineyard from them and give it to another. And then Jesus said, have you not read the stone that the builders have rejected has become the head of the corner, and it is marvelous in our eyes. So brothers and sisters, we, brothers and sisters, the church, the bride of Christ, don't let anybody get you all tore up about all these different names. The true church is the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ. Israel, talking about some of the things, talk about Israel being the bride of the Father, or the firstborn of the Father of the nation of Israel, in some different Bible verses in the Old Testament. So we, the true church, who will be raptured, those of us who will be raptured by the grace of God, by grace through faith, we are the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ. And see, what it is the Lord wanted to grow a certain type of apple, a certain type of fruit. He said that the kingdom will be taken from you, when he's telling to the Pharisees, and give it to another who will bear much fruit. You know, and I will send you prophets and apostles. You know, and then they will bear much fruit. And so, brothers and sisters, we are the apple tree, the apples that the Lord chose. He already knew what kind we would be. He took a start of the people who had the faith. As Romans chapter 4, Paul says that, you know, not all who are the natural seed of Abraham are the children of Abraham, but those who do like Abraham did, who had the faith of Abraham, just like the Lord Jesus Christ said in the Gospel of John also, when he was in the temple and he said, you know, he was talking to them and he said, you know, those who are born free are free indeed. Those whom the Son sets free are free indeed. And then these Jewish people said, oh, we've never been anybody's slaves. We're free, which was not true. They had been in bondage in Egypt in the natural. But Jesus said, those who sin are a slave to sin. And then they said, that they were the children of Abraham. And Jesus said, no, if you were the children of Abraham, you would believe on me. And then they said, but he said, I come from my father. And they said, oh, who is your father? Now, a lot of people don't realize in the subtext of what they were saying that Jesus was illegitimate. Oh, well, who is your father? Didn't we say rightly say that you are a Samaritan and demon possessed? They told Jesus he was a demon possessed and a Samaritan, which means mixed blood. You know, he wasn't an Israelite. You know, they were insulting him at the highest levels of blasphemy and insult to the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's when Jesus said to them, no, if you were God's children, you know, you would believe on me and you would do the works, you know, of Abraham. You would do the works of what God would have you do. But no, you're of your father, the devil, who is a liar, and the father thereof. He was a liar from the beginning and the father thereof. So they were bearing, listen to what I'm saying, the fruit that they were bearing was not the fruit of, they were crab apples. They were not bearing the fruit that the Lord called them to. That's why they were hewn down and cast into the fire. They were the natural branches that were thrown off, Romans 9 and 11. And we are the wild olive branch, or the apple that God that wanted to produce, the Lord wanted to produce a certain kind of apple that would be what he wanted it to be. Israel was not doing what God wanted them to be. That's why he brought in the Gentiles. Jesus said, I must first be rejected by this generation, which he was. Jesus said of that generation, it's going to be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah than for you. Sodom and Gomorrah will rise up in judgment of this generation because they have been wicked in seeking a sign, but none will be given except for the sign of the prophet Jonah. Even as Jonah was in the belly of the whale for 3 days and three nights, so shall the Son of Man be in the belly of the earth, the heart of the earth, for 3 days and three nights. And that's a whole nother sermon, brothers and sisters. But by the grace of God, brothers and sisters, I pray that you will understand. Now we know, and I've talked about this before, in Romans 11, of course, Israel will be saved in one day. They will be restored during the tribulation. The process of the tribulation is about them being restored. And that's what the Lord is leading me to tell you right now. All of these people on YouTube who are Judaizers. What I mean by Judaizers, they're trying to put us, the church, under the law. As Paul said, they're spying out the liberty we have in Christ. They're peeping on us and seeing the liberty we have in Christ. And they want to take that from us. They want to put yokes and burdens on us, the bride of Christ. As it says in 1 Timothy chapter 4, someone commented the other day on one of my videos and saying something about how they didn't believe we had to follow the law. We're saved by grace through faith, but we couldn't eat pork. Luke, 1 Timothy chapter 4 deals specifically with that topic. Acts chapter 15, we see that we, the church, are not required. The apostles all agreed, and it seemed good to them and the Holy Spirit, that the Gentiles are not required to follow the law. Praise God Almighty, brothers and sisters. In Hebrews, it says that we have a better covenant. Praise God, we have a better covenant. Praise God, a better covenant. Hallelujah. That's why it's called the New Covenant or New Testament. The New Testament. That's why when we, the bride of Christ, those of who of us are the kind of apple that the Lord wants us to be. I don't know what kind of apple that would be. What's the best? There's, you know, here in the mountain areas, we have lots of different kinds of apples that you probably never heard of. There's hundreds of kind of apples, you know, so I don't know what's the best one. But that's us, brothers and sisters. So don't let anybody try to tell you, you know, they'll say, in this metaphor, they'll say, oh, well, you know, we're all apples. We're apples. I'm looking at apples. No, brothers and sisters. You got to be specific and say, that's a crab apple. That's an apple that was a Granny Smith. That was an apple that the Lord rejected, that apple. The Lord rejected the fruit that was being produced by Israel. He rejected that fruit, brothers and sisters. Now, the day is coming, as I said, he will graft them back in, but that's not about us. We're not part of that, brothers and sisters. We're not called to that. We, the bride, are not called to that. We, the bride, are called to bring glory to God, to be the reward of his suffering. We, the church, we're called to be part of the five wise virgins. You know, five is a number of grace. We're called to be part of the five wise virgins. Matthew chapter 25. The Lord wants us to be part of that. That is the apples that the Lord has chosen and grafted in to the root of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We bypass a lot. Let me say this as the Lord has given me the unction and the inspiration to say this. Many of you probably never thought about this. When Abraham was on earth, there was no law. When Isaac and Jacob was on earth, there was no law. As a matter of fact, God didn't even do the circumcision until the time that Isaac was going to be born. Before that, it says when 25 years before Isaac was born, when Abraham was 75, the Bible says that God said to Abraham, get ye up out of the land of the Chaldeans, you know, out of Ur of the Chaldees, which I've been there, by the way, when I was in Iraq. And come out there and go to a land I will show you, which is the land of Canaan at that time, the Canaanite land. And I will make you a great nation. And it says that Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Abraham was counted righteous in the eyes of God because it said he staggered not at the promises of God. He staggered not. He didn't stagger. He didn't waver. He didn't flinch at the promises of God. As retold by the Apostle Paul from Genesis, the Apostle Paul gives us a recap of that. Romans chapter 4, you can read where Paul gives us the New Testament lens of that. So what am I saying to you, brothers and sisters, in practicality, as I mentioned the other day, don't let anybody keep talking to you about the Torah, about the law and all that. You tell them, oh, you mean the Old Testament, the Old Covenant? You mean the Old Covenant. You mean the covenant that God made with Israel. When people keep quoting from that, those things that God did, he made it as an everlasting covenant between him and Israel, between him and the natural descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, with the nation of Israel, a peculiar, particular people who rejected, who gave up their birthright, just like Esau gave up his birthright for the things of this world, for a bowl of red soup, lentil soup, to his younger brother Jacob, who became Israel. Brothers and sisters, Israel gave up their birthright when they rejected the Messiah that the Father sent. They gave up their birthright with all their idolatry and disobedience to God. Even after all of God's punishment and chastisement, as Jesus said, they were hypocrites. They did not discern the signs. They could look at the sky and say, oh, it's going to rain because it's sunny in the morning, or it's going to be fair weather because it's cloudy at night, sunny at dawn at night. But you can't discern the signs of the times, Jesus said to them. They're a wicked and perverse generation, just like it's going on in the world today, brothers and sisters, with the people of the world. They're a wicked and perverse generation. All the people of the world, other than the true bride of Christ, the Lord is going to bring his judgment upon this generation, rain down his judgment on this generation, this terminal generation, as the Lord is, in all these things, the brothers and sisters, the Lord has given me the unction to say these things. On this terminal generation, brothers and sisters, they shall see the wrath of God abiding on themselves. see it. Now it's just, oh, well, you know, pie in the sky one day when I die, then I'll worry about it, pie in the sky. No, 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 they will see it, brothers and sisters, with their own eyes. They will see it. This wicked and perverse generation that we are walking in the midst of right now, brothers and sisters, just as Abraham walked among the wicked and evil people in the land of Canaan, just as Isaac strove with the wicked people that tried to refill the wells that Abraham had dug, his son Isaac, these wicked Canaanites and those people, they tried to fill up the wells that Isaac was trying to use that belonged to his father. That's another whole other sermon. And then his son Jacob, living amongst the wicked and perverse people, some even members of his own household, some of his children. Brothers and sisters, praise God that we are that fruit, the reward of the Lord's suffering. And let the redeemed of the Lord say so. That's a Bible verse. Also, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. The Lord wants you to understand that we are the reward, the bride. We are the reward of His suffering. You know, that's what people, this problem with these people that don't believe in the rapture and all that. See, they think they're going to suffer. They want the reward of their suffering. See, but Jesus paid it all. And all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all. Now all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Praise God Almighty. Jesus already paid it all, brothers and sisters. Praise God. He purchased us with His own blood. Hallelujah. You're not your own. You've been bought with a price. Hallelujah. What's the price? The blood of Jesus. The stripes of the Lord Jesus Christ. 30, 40 save one. 39 stripes the Lord took for us. His church. Praise God for us. Who are those apples that He wants, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. That we've been grafted in. Hallelujah. Praise His name. He's the same in the beginning and in the end. Hallelujah. And the Lord has just prompted me to say that too, brothers and sisters, that from Ecclesiastes, as it was in the beginning, so shall it be in the end. Hallelujah. Praise God, brothers and sisters. He's going back. As far as we, the church, are concerned, the days are going back to the days of Israel. God dealing with Israel and individuals all the way back to the days of Noah. All of those things, brothers and sisters, it's going back as it was in the beginning. But we, the church, we, the true bride, we're going to be with our Lord. John chapter 14, the Lord said He will come and receive us to Himself, and where He is, we may be also, in His Father's house, in those many mansions. Hallelujah. Praise God Almighty. He's going to gather us unto Himself, brothers and sisters. For the Bible says the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we forever be with the Lord. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, 17, and 18. Wherefore, 18, therefore, comfort one another with these words. Praise God. We're supposed to be comforted in that, brothers and sisters. Comforted that so shall we forever be with the Lord. And when he returns to earth at the end of the tribulation, Jude tells us, actually quoting from Enoch, seventh from Adam, you know, seven is the number of completion. Like a Shemitah year. Seven times seven, 49, the 50th year of the Jubilee year. And the Enoch, seventh from Adam, said the Lord will return to earth with 10,000s. That's a plural, 10,000s of His saints. Hallelujah. We're going to return with the Lord. And the Bible says that we'll rule and reign with Christ on this earth after the tribulation. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Praise God. What a wonderful thing that the Lord has prepared for those who love Him. Hallelujah. Romans 8, 28. Hallelujah. All things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to His purposes. Praise God. His purpose is what? To receive glory, honor, and praise. Hallelujah. Through His church, through the fruit that His tree bears. So like in the days of Israel, when the Lord Jesus Christ was walking into Jerusalem during the Passion Week, and He saw that fig tree, and He cursed it because it wasn't bearing fruit. He said every tree that does not bear fruit should be cut down and cast into the fire. And he was disappointed. The Lord said, oh, Jerusalem, how I would love to have, I'm not yelling because it's 2 o'clock in the morning. How I would love to preach it, brothers and sisters. He said, oh, Jerusalem, how I would love to gather you like a mother hen gathers her chicks. But you would not. They weren't willing. They rejected and refused. Jesus said, as God, you know, God, how many times, how often? Not just that day, on that day when the Lord went in there, on Palm Sunday, but how many times had the Lord wanted to gather them as a mother hen? That wasn't on Palm Sunday, but it doesn't matter. But during the Passion Week, how often would love to gather you like a mother hen gathers her chicks, but you would not. They rejected the Christ. They rejected the will of God. My brothers and sisters, with us, the true bride, those things are not to be. Those things ought not be and will not be for those of us who have given our hearts to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's bought us with a price. He's made a new covenant. He's written His law in our hearts. Hallelujah. His Spirit indwells us. The Holy Spirit indwells those of us who are in the new covenant, in the New Testament. He's in us and to us and through us. Hallelujah. Praise God. That Emmanuel, God is with us. Praise His holy name, brothers and sisters. You ought to give a shout to God for all that He's done. You know, look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He saved my mind. Or He cleared my mind. I think it is. He healed my mind. He saved me just in time. Hallelujah. Look what the Lord has done. Hallelujah. What He's done. He's done it. Jesus paid it all. And all to Him I owe. Amen. He's done it all. I can't really get so loud, brothers and sisters. But it's a call to celebration. We should be celebrating Jesus Christ, you know, like Don Moen, celebrate Jesus, celebrate, celebrate Jesus, celebrate. You know, it's a celebration that we have in the church. I can't help all the sorrows that's happened in the history of the world, even in the church, in those times when the Christians were fed the lions. You know, we can't help that there are Christians who are persecuted today by ISIS, the Coptic Christians, all those things. We can't help that, brothers and sisters. You talking about in the natural. See, people say, oh, how can we celebrate? There's Christians who are persecuted. There are Christians who are in jail in Saudi Arabia. There are Christians who are in jail in China. All these kind of things. There are Christians who have been killed in the Philippines. Missionaries on the same place where I am, a missionary in the Philippines. There are missionaries who were a husband and wife. They even made a movie about it and all that. They were captured by the Muslim radicals and the husband was killed. The wife was able to get set free and she wrote a book. Brothers and sisters, our celebration, the problem with lots of people, and that's a whole other message. You know, they're looking at the natural and they're saying, you know, there is no reason to celebrate. Or if they have maybe a lot of money, they celebrate about that or whatever it is. You're talking about natural things. Just like Israel, you know, you're doing like what Israel's doing. You're looking at the natural. You know, the natural promised land, Israel, the nation of Israel, natural promised land. When I'm talking about as a Christian, as part of the bride of Christ, as it says in Hebrews chapter 11, this is called the faith chapter, it says, you know, Abraham and them, they had faith in God, but they were looking for a promise of not an earthly. Hebrews chapter 11 says they were not looking for an earthly city, but a city not made with hands. They were looking for the heavenly city. They were looking for the kingdom of God in heaven, not in the natural. That's why Paul says, set your eyes on things above, not on things of this world. That's the biggest problem I have dealing with people, you know, as a pastor and YouTube and anywhere that I deal with people as a pastor. I take that back as a prophet of God, is that people are looking at the natural. They're not looking at the spiritual. I can make 100 videos on this topic, and the Lord is just dumping it on me. Just like Elisha and his servant. You know, the Syrian army came to arrest him because they said, how is it that Elisha knows everything we're doing? You know, they said, how is it the king of Israel knows everything that we're doing? And then his generals in Syria said, well, you know, he's got a prophet that's telling us. He's in the, you know, he's overhearing everything we say because he's a prophet of God, of the God of Israel. So they went to arrest him, and the servant of Elisha was scared to death, you know, shaking his boots. And Elisha said, well, there's more with us than there are with them. And there was just the two of them, you know. And Elisha said, there's more with us than there are with them. And then his servant, you know, kind of like most of the people I deal with, you know, Christians, and like the Israel, like an average Israelite throughout the Bible, they're like, what's up? What are you talking about? And that's when Elisha said, well, you know, he prayed and said, well, you know, God, can you open his eyes? Let him see. And then he saw the fiery chariots of Israel, the fiery chariots of the angels, circling around him and his master, Elisha. And then he saw that there were more. And then that's when Elisha said, you know, he struck the people, all the whole army, with blindness. And then he led them to the king of Israel. And then the king of Israel said, my father, to Elisha, my father, what shall I do with these men? Should we kill them or what? You have to go read that story yourself and find out what happened. The rest of the story to find out, like Paul Harvey used to say. Brothers and sisters, I could go on and on as the Lord has given me these things. I need to write these things down. The Lord is just, he is wonderful. God is wonderful, mighty counselor. Hallelujah. Praise his name, as it says there in Isaiah, talking about the Messiah. He is our wonderful, everlasting Father, a mighty counselor. He is our Redeemer, our Creator. And he should be the love of your life. He has delivered you from the kingdom of darkness and translated you to the kingdom of his dear Son. Praise God. We've been translated from the kingdom of darkness already. Our spirits have already been translated. Now, those of you who know these words, translated, is what happens at the rapture. When the resurrection happens, we're translated. Our physical bodies will be translated to that new supernatural body. But right now, our spirits have already been translated. Praise God. That's why Jesus said, you know, born again. We were spiritually dead. Now we're spiritually reborn. Our spirits have already been translated from the kingdom of darkness, the Bible tells us, to the kingdom of his dear Son. I believe that's in Colossians. Praise God, brothers and sisters, for the word of God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. As I mentioned before, tomorrow night I'll be on the radio. Starts at 9:30 Eastern Standard Time on this Tribulation Now radio. So I ask you to pray about that if you have time to listen. Of course, he posts all of his radio shows on YouTube. You can listen to it later on. But I ask you to pray that God will, you know, anoint me with what he wants to be said on the radio show, and that his will be done. And then as I've already told you guys, the weekend of the 12th, 13th, and 14th of June, I will be in Nashville to meet with brothers and sisters there in that area. I ask you to pray about that, brothers and sisters, for safe travel. And praise God for that, brothers and sisters, as I will be praying about making a schedule, who, when, where, why, and how to go to Seattle, Dallas, and other places that the Lord would make a way for me to go. I ask you guys to please pray for me on those things. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I really want to do some preaching, but we're new here. I don't know how well people might be able to hear me if I start yelling upstairs. You know, this is the States, not like in the Philippines, where people have freedom in the Philippines. Here in the States, you know, there are people, they might think you're fighting and call the law on you. Who knows? You know, until I get to know my neighbors. So anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I appreciate your all the viewers who ever watch me. I'm praying for you. You know, I've got a backlog of books and oil, the prayer oil that people have requested, and I'm going to be trying to get that out, brothers and sisters. I mean, I just got moved in yesterday. I still got to get arranged here. By the grace of God, this week I'll be sending out those people, the oil and books that people have requested from me. So, praise God. I ask you to pray about that too, brothers and sisters, that everyone will receive their prayer oil safely, books and all those things, by the grace of God. And you know, all those of you who have asked me to pray for all your different situations I have, still going to do, as the Lord leads me, the words list, as the Lord leads me. Can only do it as the Lord leads me, brothers and sisters. God bless you all. Love you all. Thank you for watching. And I appreciate every one of you. I appreciate every person I've ever got to talk to through the YouTube and minister to, and who have ministered to me. Some of you guys have ministered to me, so praise God. Thank you, Lord, for my brothers and sisters in Christ from the internet. Praise God.